What are we doing?
Good evening and welcome to the February 10th meeting of the Hampton Board of Selectmen. Please stand and salute to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to introduce the board. To my far left, Selectman Mike Pierce. To my immediate left, Selectman Phil Bean. To my far right, Selectman Mike Pluck. To his left, Selectman Mary Louise Woolsey. To my immediate right, Town Manager Fred Welch. And I'm Chairman Dick Nichols. First item on the agenda tonight is public comment period. Would somebody from the public wish to comment? Dave?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the Board of Selectmen. For the record, my name is David Lang. I live at 66 Park Avenue. I come before you this evening to address a situation that came about, I guess at the last Selectmen's meeting that I was able to watch online, in which I, as a taxpayer, as a participant in our democracy, took the floor of the town meeting, the deliberative session, made a motion, amended the operating budget, which was my right. It was seconded. It was discussion and debate, and ultimately it was passed. I am quite concerned to find out that after participating in our democracy, that a member of this board would call me out, call into question my motives, call into question what I did or what I didn't do. I find it very troubling. I find it troubling in this day and age when we're trying to get more participation in government that in this type of way we would have what I'm going to infer as a potential intimidating tactic in which we say to our citizenry, if you make a motion that we don't like, then you will appear before the Board of Selectmen by name. I think that's problematic for us. If we continue this practice, then Mr. and Mrs. Smith on Main Street, Mr. and Mrs. Smith on High Street and Winnicott Road will not be participating in our democracy, which will be really sad. I made a motion to have the town of Hampton remove itself, have the money removed from the budget, so that we were no longer members of the New Hampshire Municipal Association. I was troubled to find out that the chairman himself was talking to the Municipal Association at 5 o'clock last Monday night and was represented to you, which I've known you a long time, Dick, and I don't have any reason to believe that you would not be reporting accurately what you heard. But you were told that there was no connection any longer, that there was separate and independent, and that there was no connection between the NHMA and the risk pools. I find it troubling that the very next day before the House Commerce Committee that we find representatives from the NHMA testifying in favor of a position which would allow or require mandatory membership in the New Hampshire Municipal Association or associations to belong to the risk pool. That bill was House Bill 1643, in which I brought 1363, in which I brought a copy today. So not more than 24 hours later, I would like to remind the town that RSA 318A says that you selectmen can pay dues provided that there was not an appropriation that has been rejected by the town meeting. This was passed in 1961, long time before Senate Bill 2 was even thought of. I think the courts, while I'm not an attorney, would probably find that the deliberative session of the town meeting are one and the same for the purposes of this. I'm also troubled by a bill that was placed before the Senate that deals with the inspection and the creation of a code enforcement board in which representatives from the New Hampshire Municipal Association go and in a joking way testify against it as supposedly an unfunded mandate. I have a minute and 20 seconds left, Mr. Chairman. I'm being mindful of time. But they testified against this bill. The individual that was representing the NHMA actually laughed during his testimony, saying that he built his house himself and it didn't meet code, and therefore we didn't need this building code. I don't think that's the Hampton we want. We spent a tremendous amount of time, energy, and effort in making sure that the beach properties of one we own, my wife and I, was up to code. So, Mr. Chairman and members of the Board of Selectmen, If we belong to the New Hampshire Municipal Association because we get representation services, I suggest to you, for the $15,000 we pay, we get a better deal. And that's with the state senator and the five state reps that we have that get $100 a year plus mileage. So why don't we use them more? And if we're doing it for legal advice, you have two full-time attorneys on staff. I don't believe that this board wants to trade that $15,000 dues for the two full-time attorneys that serve this town well. So I would once again respectfully request that we do not challenge the motives of individuals, that we do not challenge our participants in this democracy. It's not good for our government. It's not good for this town. And it certainly does not bode well for the good name that the Board of Selectmen are supposed to uphold of the town of Hampton. And with that and 3 seconds remaining, I would yield back the balance of my time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Somebody else from the public? Arthur?
Art Moody, 3 Thompson Road. I had a number of things. Last week you gave our Ashworth Avenue parking lot to an out-of-town group for September 13th, Saturday, this year, this coming year. When, if the weather's good, we'd make big money on that lot in the parking department. Unbelievable. It should be something like 22 September before you start giving away town resources for the off-season. In fact, your parking leases, I think, go to October 1st or something. Is that taken care of that weekend, that Saturday? People who have paid through September, October 1st? Also, last week, you gave permission to encumber the right-of-way sidewalk on Highland Avenue for the Ashworth Hotel facelift, putting a scaffolding and, I guess, building materials, and Jersey barriers in Highland Avenue roadway itself. That speaks for the need to keep setbacks in that zone, business seasonal zone. One of the zoning articles is to eliminate major setbacks in that zone, North Beach, South Beach, Winnicott Road south to the river for multifamily. We even lease town property for maintenance easement on Ashworth Avenue. Setbacks, use your own property, or don't build to the lot line. Also, 149M on the ballot to give the selectmen authority on sewers. I'd like to see a legal opinion, as I stated at the deliberative session, whether the ordinance, the long sewer ordinance, will be in the hands of the selectmen with its first item prohibition against any more out-of-town sewer lines. If not, if there's no legal opinion that, or if that ordinance goes with the power, then I'll be voting no and drafting my letter to the editor. Likewise, I'd like to last, if I've got time. Oh, I've got all kinds of time. I got Dave's 3 seconds too. He said I could have it. Last week you had the annual review and adoption of investment policy on the agenda, but you pulled it. As I remember that statute when it went into effect, trustees of trust funds have to do it also. The treasurer is involved with the selectmen in that process, that annual process, but I didn't hear the name of the, I didn't hear that the treasurer was involved in the consultations on this that's now on the agenda for tonight again. Last thing, the stop sign ordinances that you said DPW found must have taken a week, 3 corners of the town, to find stop sign in intersections that are not in the general code book by that company in New York. called General Code, which in my opinion should be demoted to Private Code, fourth class. That elephant, white elephant, you've encumbered $20,000 more to update and fix. It's unfixable. Last week you said there was 50. Well, you didn't say. You didn't say how many stop sign ordinances you were passing by that one vote. But I got a copy, 3 pages, 50. And it's very poor staff work by somebody. It repeats on page 2 and 3 of page 1. Misspell town road names. Stop signs at extensions of old road that the selectmen have never named. Private property stop signs. One stop sign that I brought to your attention last fall that the next week you put on that code is in there, Scott Road. That's the one the state put in when they redid the road in 1996. The best one, though, is Hackett Lane, southbound to the intersection of Moore Avenue and Kershaw Avenue. Kershaw Avenue and Moore Avenue don't intersect. So I don't know what they had in mind on that one. It's a it's very humorous reading. Even the ones that are in the General Code book are just unbelievable. Some of the directions. And two of the three yield intersections are just out of their mind where they're putting them. One's in the middle of a road, Winneconnet Road, when you turn left on Park. There's no yield sign in the middle of the road, but it says it is. Thanks.
Okay, Arthur. Somebody else from the public? Okay, seeing none. Announcements and community calendar. Mike?
No, thank you.
Bill?
Yes, sir, I do. Seeing as it is contestant time with the Olympics going on, the New England Newspaper and Press Association is a professional trade organization for 450 daily and weekly newspapers in New England. And amongst us tonight, we have a silver medal winner and a bronze winner. Nick Reed, the Hampton Union reporter, took second place for government reporting for his coverage of a backlog in fiber inspections in Hampton. Reed went on for the bronze with his fellow homie, Patrick Cronin, and took third place in the Right to Know category for, in the judge's words, excellent coverage on Hampton shutting off TV video during a ZBA meeting. So, scintillating work, Nick. Great stuff. Additionally, Howard Altshuler, Seacoast Media Group's executive editor, and a very fine group it is, was named Editorial Writer of the Year, honors for daily newspapers, under 30,000 in circulation. His editorials are a joy. They're hard-hitting. They're well-argued, and they're easy to read. So every community should be blessed to have the great press coverage that we do with the Hampton Union and the Seacoast Media Group. Nick, hope you get the gold next year. Congratulations.
Mike?
Oh, all set.
Mary Louise?
Looks like another storm heading our way Thursday and Friday of this week. Please go online and sign up for your email notifications from the Department of Public Works. And number two, we're a month away now from the annual election. When you go in and mark your ballot and say what's happening for the coming year, please remember to educate yourself first and then vote.
Okay. First appointment, Fire Chief Silva, related to the traffic lights at High Street and Lafayette Road. Chris?
Good evening, members of the board. This issue was brought to me first time, I believe, during the summer of 2012. And there were concerns about the phasing sequence of the signal at Lafayette High Exeter Road for the northbound and southbound left-hand turning lanes. And as it was at that time, the turning lane was permitted to begin the turn prior to north and southbound receiving the green light. For whatever reason, it was brought to my attention that that was problematic,
and that vehicles were being essentially like trapped in the intersection. Someone may be waiting to make the left turn, then the signal would go to red, and there was no way to permit them to continue to proceed through the intersection. So we contacted the company that does all of our traffic signal work, and they suggested, let's move the sequence after the permissive green. So instead of being permitted to make the left turn prior to north and south, south proceeding, let's allow north and south to proceed, allow traffic to make the turn left after they yield to oncoming traffic, as law requires. And then if a car happens to be in the intersection when the signal changes, they would then get a green arrow permitting them to clear the intersection. That's the way the signal is programmed as it is now. It appears that there is some confusion as people travel through that intersection. Could it be that it's a change? Could it be that it's not signalized with the right timing? Could it be that it's not noticed? I'm not sure. But in 2013, we were asked to reevaluate it. Now, myself, as the fire chief, have no experience with traffic controls, other than we do some maintenance on them and we change the bulbs. Mm-hmm. The police chief and I and the public works director discussed it, and really none of us had the experience to say there was any one way better than another without having any evaluation of the intersection. So we'd recommended that we employ the service of a traffic safety engineer and tell us what the best way to signalize the intersection is. We did that. And we did receive a report back, and not only did we get a recommendation, but we also received several other recommendations for that intersection that at some point in the future we will need to address. I don't intend to discuss all of those tonight, but I think we need to focus on how we want to address the change in signals for the turns. So we have really three choices. We can leave the signal the way it is now. We could put the signal back to the way it was prior to the fall of 2012, or we can accept the recommendation of Sebago Technics and change the configuration so that the left turning lanes are protected turn only. In other words, you're only permitted to turn left through that intersection when you have a green arrow. And if you don't have a green arrow, then you would have a red arrow and would not be permitted to make the turn. What this does is it permits any north or southbound left-turning traffic to turn in a totally protected way so that they would not be interfered with by the straight through the intersection vehicles. They would not be trapped in the intersection because they would never be in a position that they would be waiting to yield to traffic to make their turns. And I think at this point it probably makes the most sense to make that change. Now, of course, that does require some physical modifications to the signalization because there are no red arrows presently. So one piece of the signal where presently there's a 5-light combination would have to be changed to a 3-light combination with a green arrow, yellow, and a red arrow. Now, I don't know exactly what that cost would be because we haven't solicited bids or cost proposals. What we do have are estimates, which I think are on the conservatively high side for this, at about $5,000. So I was asked by the board to come back with a recommendation. You have three options. My recommendation would be follow the suggestions of Sebago Technics. Let's change the intersection signalization. I think it makes the most sense. It certainly improves safety for those turning in the intersection.
Okay, questions, comments from the board?
I agree with the chief. I'm back and forth through that intersection every day and on weekends, basically. And I can't imagine how we ever got stuck with this configuration to begin with. But the left turn lane should go first, period, with nobody trying to get down going straight through. I cannot imagine what, who person thought that up. Fix them. I'll vote for whatever amount you need to get the signals. It's ridiculous to have people turn. You've got the green light going. You've got turning, and that, and you've got the southbound traffic going. And in the meantime, the light changes, and all of the northbound traffic are coming at. It's crazy. Take the recommendation that the chief has put on the table. Let's get the lights ordered and fix it. Please.
I would make the motion that we accept the chief's course of action recommendation.
Second.
Discussion?
Yes, I'd like to say something about that. Did you say that if we go to this totally isolated left turn, wherever you call that, it'll be after all the traffic goes across?
No, it doesn't necessarily need to be. It could be at the beginning of the sequence. So they could be permitted to turn left prior to northbound. The good thing is the intersection has what are referred to as loop controllers. So in the roadway, there are sensors. Mm-hmm. And those sensors help direct the controller on mm-hmm. which signal it should give
yes.
next. So if there were no one in the turning lane, it may not give a left turn arrow mm-hmm. during that particular time in the sequence. So if someone came into the intersection wanting to turn left, mm-hmm. once the sequence has already begun, it may require that they wait until the other traffic sequence has finished,
yeah.
and then at the next opportunity they would be permitted to turn.
So we can have it before the north-south traffic commences, mm-hmm. or we can have it afterwards. And I may suggest that if you do it before, that might be more a better choice, because afterwards you've got the people who might want to turn left trying to also blocking the traffic from going straight north to the intersection. So I can see there'd be a mess if it's afterwards. I can just see that without even looking at it. So before is probably the smart way to do it, if I had to decide.
I'm voting.
Hold it. Do I get to speak? Or thank you. Chris, do your recommendations also include the changing on the clearance intervals, the time of the yellow?
The timing, that's an easy change.
Okay.
That's just
so
basically a programming,
that.
Yes. There were two other recommendations that I think we'll need to look at some point in
right,
the future.
Right, but they're big bucks. My only other question is there some sort of a line item that's got a budget for this kind of stuff, and where's the, what you're saying is he says 6,000, but you're saying that's probably on the high side. Where would we intend to pay for this from?
There's a traffic control budget and a public works budget.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what the cost is. Do you have it with you, Keith?
The cost,
what's in the budget?
Okay. So we're basically saying we'll eat up.
We'll
wipe that out, but it's probably also the most important intersection in town from
yes.
some level. So.
Okay,
all in favor?
Crazy.
Unanimous. Okay,
thank
good.
You.
Thank you.
Fast, Chief, really fast, right? He's laughing at me.
How you doing, Keith?
Good evening, Keith. Hi, Chris.
Good evening.
Tired of the winter yet?
Very much so. This time of year. I've often said that if at least the snowstorms wait until after the first of the year, it seems like it just goes a lot faster. When they start as early as they did this year, it just tends to drag on and wear everybody's patience then, and I can see that happening as time goes on.
Spoken like a real New Englander.
So, good evening. So I'm here to talk about the last quarter of 2013. It was another busy and productive quarter for Public Works. I provided you should have got on Friday, I think there's about 4 or 5 pages of things that myself and my staff have worked on through the quarter, and as you can see, we got a lot accomplished and worked on a lot of different things. My main focus for that quarter, without a doubt, was really the Old Mill Pond Dam engineering. That took a lot of my time, working with state officials, preparing the grant. Even though we just submitted the grant, there was still we've been working on that for about 4 months now. And then, of course, working on the budget and getting prepared for a town meeting. The two major projects that I've been directly involved with is the II study for Hampton Beach being accomplished by Underwood Engineers. They're on target to have the report, final report, in by June of this year. One of the reasons that's being delayed, but it's taken that long, is because they're going to do flow isolation and flow monitoring, strategic flow monitoring, during the spring thaw, where they'll be getting some good information on groundwater and so forth. So I spoke by email to Keith Pratt, who's the president of Underwood Engineers, today, and he assured me that they've already started the projects by doing a lot of the reconnaissance as far as obtaining water records from Aquarian Water Company, as well as they've gone down there during some of the storm events and got some good data on, or at least pictures on, you know, some of the manholes that are submerged and showing the leakage and opening them up and checking that out. So they're all on target. And the other one is, of course, Exeter Road Engineering, being done by CMA Engineers. And they've done all the, they've done the preliminary design, and they're just looking at right now scheduling for the televising of the sewer lines and the drain lines. And they're going to be doing that over the next month, month and a half. So so if you have any questions of my projects, I'd be happy to answer them. And I'm going to turn it over to Chris, and he'll be talking about some of the projects that he's been working on.
I have one question kind of related, related to the II. And it has to do with what the maximum hydraulic flow is. For a long time, I had the impression it was about 3.9 million gallons a day, and that's without taking into consideration any holding areas that you may have and whatever.
Right.
And I saw something recently that was 4.4 million. I think it came from, I don't remember if it was Underwood or Wright Pierce. And I was just curious if there was some sort of evaluation of work done that increased the 3.9, or that was a different number.
I can't say where that would have come from. All of our numbers are, you know, on the 4 side or below.
So you can't make sense of what the 4.4 was then?
No.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. So ring a bell.
Okay, so 3.9 is, from your standpoint, 3.9 is still the maximum hydraulic flow then, not including, you know, holding.
Well, Mike, and you know, probably Mike Doobie's better suited to answer that question when he is going to step up here.
Okay.
Very
good.
Yeah. That's highlights from my perspective have been the Lafayette and High Street hazard mitigation grant, as you all know or recall. The preliminary design was presented to the town October 24th, and we've been keeping the state appraised through quarterly reports. The hazardous, really homeland security section of the government agreed, multiple conversations with them. They agreed just to give them quarterly updates, even if the update says we're not, you know, we're still in the holding pattern, i.e., waiting for town meeting, whatever. Pleased to say that West Side Sewer Project, the majority of the work is wrapped up. The numbers fall out. Perkins Ave, 465 feet of sewer main replaced and 3 manholes. Auburn Ave, 507 feet of sewer main replaced and 1 new manhole. 1 manhole replaced and 2 new manholes. And Auburn Ave extension, 196 feet of sewer main replaced there. Training-wise, for me, I was able to successfully complete first year of management training through the local government center. It's a series of 6 classes spaced out through the year, various topics. It's been very, very worthwhile for me. No direct cost out of our budget with respect to that because of our membership. The other big thing that we were glad to assist people to do was the curbing installation at the front of the galley hatch, that intersection. We did get 3 separate quotes. I used the lowest one, but the really pleasing part was, and it goes to the Mr. Tinius, when I had selected the lowest provider, he wanted more curb done. He wanted a more, if you remember, it was going to be segmental. We were just closing off some options. He said, I'd really like to get the whole thing done. said, well, I can only authorize the share under that agreement, and he said, I'll pay for my part. Good. I gave him an upset number, and thankfully I came in under the upset number by a few dollars, but he paid for half, and we paid for half, and there was no float. We didn't have to float his, if you will, share of the project. And I was very pleased to see that we could actually, you know, that people can move together in the right direction to accomplish a common goal. We do have a new contractor for the landfill monitoring. That's their company name is Cardinal ATC. They're out of Manchester. Wright Pierce, who was our former contractor for that landfill monitoring and reporting work, is no longer in the business. They've closed off that particular section of what they do. I have, even though it's not fourth quarter business, I have received their final report, and it was shipped off to the state. I received it probably a week and a half ago. Over on Barber Road at Sherburn, we did put in the fall the two catch basins, interconnected those with pipe, and the plan is to connect that all the way down towards the Victory Garden. To that effort, we did start down at the Victory Garden, put in a nice settling basin in the fall, helped out the people at the garden. They asked for some brush reduction in around the garden. That was done. Toby is most glad to help them out. And then they installed 112 feet of pipe away from that, heading out towards the road. And it's our desire that through the summer and into the fall, as time allows, their high sewer and drain staff is going to continue that project. They have the pipe. We have the plans. We know where we're going. It's just going to be we're just going to bite it off as they can do it, along with their other critical work.
So when it's ultimately done, what is the start point and what is the end point?
The start point will be the two basins at Sherburn will drain all the way down to the Victory Garden.
Okay.
But it'll also pick up drainage along the road.
Okay. So there's nothing involved in this anyway between Sherburn and Mill Road then?
Correct.
Okay.
Right. At present, they're not interconnected.
I got one quick question. Is that going to dump into that little creek that goes under Barber Road?
Not directly. There's probably 200 feet of woods that the water would have to overflow and disperse through before it would ever reach that brook.
That'd be on the north side of Barber, back in the woods a ways.
Correct.
In between the Victory Garden and that little slough, whatever it's called.
Yep.
It starts with an S. Never
Nihilus. Nihilus Brook.
There you go, Nihilus. There you go. Thank you.
Yep.
That's all I had. Thank you.
Any questions for me?
Nope. Thank you very much.
I have a couple of questions. Nice job at the galley hatch and the curbing and so forth. I hate to see public works crews having to do that in November. I'm hoping we can get freed up a little bit so that more of that work can be done in the good weather, so that we have the manpower instead of chasing trash all the time. Who's responsible for the Victory Garden, Fred? Where does that fall?
It's under a private group in town that works, I think, in conjunction with the Heritage Commission. Is there in charge?
Well, that's
of
town
the
land.
Blacksmith shop and the barrel shop, and there's a group that works together with the Heritage Commission on that particular.
But that's
facility.
Still town land. I think
yes.
We ought to have a little. I have
Conservation Commission pointed out. They came back to me and pointed out that they had the control, monitoring, oversight, if you will.
Okay. Now I'm
from
making
yeah. Right.
A mental note to, because I have some questions on that eventually, yep. Nothing to do with public works. Let's see. And the EPA. Yeah, where are we on that MS4? We have joint council, and we're still trudging along, basically?
The EPA received over 1,000 pages of written comment.
Good.
They're obligated to go through each and every single page and address each and every single page back in writing.
Serves them right.
And so I'm sure that some of the comments may, in fact, make it into the permit.
Okay.
But they've got their work cut out for them to complete that 1,000-page review.
So we have time.
Yes.
To pull the pieces into place.
Right.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. Good stuff.
I take it back. I did have one, Chris. On the place called Beach Wall Repair, it says Town Highway Department will be going into the site this summer. I would suggest that you, whatever time they go in, you try and get that done before Memorial Day.
Right. Correct.
Anyway.
Yep.
And the other thing is I know we've talked about this several times, but is there a plan to try and take some of the material that's just sitting there not doing anything? What I mean by that, there's 5 or 6 boulders, 2 feet, 3 feet in diameter, mm-hmm. that are not protecting anything, that are just still sitting out there from the February storm last year. Mm-hmm. And we had a discussion trying to turn those into a jetty to protect the granite steps so we don't have the same situation again.
I think we're going to get the opportunity to do that along with the work that's going to get done on Northeast Lane and those properties further up the beach. So we do have a chance to get in there and, if you will, revisit it.
Before Memorial Day or
right.
whatever. Okay,
yep.
Good. Thank you.
As long as it stops snowing.
Mm-hmm.
As long as it stops snowing.
Better than ice. Nice.
Thank you.
Right.
Hi, Mike.
Hi. Evening, everyone. To answer your question on the design, the 3.9 is what we used to run at, or the capacity used to be at, before we had our last major upgrades of the aeration system.
Oh.
And GHD, when they initially put in the permit to renew the application to renew our permit, they had that 3.9 in there, which it shouldn't have been. It should have been 4.7.
Oh.
So we had Wright Pierce do the a study on that and to show that we could handle 4.7 if, as long as all the aeration tanks we can open up. Because right now we're running off a different process. It's MLE, which is with the biological.
So if I understand you correctly, for purposes of the denominator in the magic calculation of when you get to 80%,
mm-hmm.
and, DES or whatever says, nope, you can't build anymore, the denominator is now 4.7 as opposed to 3.9.
Yeah.
That's huge. That's huge in terms of, if we're at 2.2 million gallons or whatever, we would have been over 50% at 3.9, whereas at 4.7, you're not even close, so... Super.
So my projects were pretty much the Church Street project going on, and then some other small stuff. The dewatering is going good. The last 3 months, we've been averaging about 26.8%.
Wow.
And, you can see it on the hauling the sludge up to Rochester, that it's definitely bringing up less. Good. The Church Street project is going good. It's about 80% done now. Penta has requested a time extension of 35 days to meet the substantial completion. So the date for the substantial completion is February 28th. So it's right around the corner. They're going to be turning the pumps on. It won't be totally done with that site project because they still got to fill in the old pump station and do some grading of the parking lot and stuff like that. But once that's completed, I was hoping to set up a tour, have anybody interested in come by and check it out and see what the new station looks like. We're currently working with the state and Smutty Nose on their industrial discharge permit. They want to start brewing within a month. It's right around the corner. And with the permit, we're still waiting for our new discharge permit from EPA. All in all, things are going good down there, and the crew is doing an excellent job.
Quick question. Great job, Mike. Really good job.
Thanks.
You mentioned the manhole frames and being replaced. Do we have need for any more of the, I think they're gasket cover sewer Are we all set at the beach, or are we still getting backup? We pretty much, and I forget the technical term for those things, but the manhole covers that don't pop up and let the water through. Do you think we've pretty well covered all the areas that need to have those installed?
No, we're waiting until we get the results of the II study. Some of the worst ones have been taken, but they're about labor and materials, about a couple of $1,000 a piece to do, so... we're going to do it as we get the report in to make sure, you know, prioritizing the replacement of those.
I thought that question would be useful.
In anticipation that we've already ordered 12.
So we still have a ways to go.
Right.
Very good. Good.
Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
I think Pete probably.
I have a couple of questions if you don't mind. So the delay would be basically because of extremely cold weather and so forth. That
I'm going to be talking about that, the next item.
Okay, you want to wait till that later? Okay. One other question. If we decide to, instead of spending our money foolishly and putting it on private property, and we decide to put in a bathroom facility on that property, how much of a big problem would that be in relation to looking at the physical layout? Not any political opinions, just... how much of a job would that be able to do?
Well, there is currently a toilet and sink installed inside the pump station.
Really?
So.
It doesn't mean people go in there.
Yeah,
now, the question is, would that be accessible to parking lot attendants?
Yeah, I wouldn't feel comfortable.
Okay, so we'd have to put something outside the building.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that's doable probably for a reasonable cost. At least it's reasonable putting it on church property. Okay, and that's all you need to know about that. So there was one other question I was going to ask about the, I don't know who to ask about this. So when you're looking at the 3.9, what would you call it, ambient flow or maximum flow, and the 4.7, now what do we normally run at, about 2.2?
Yeah, things have been somewhat dry
right
now. So
when we have a big insurge from a storm that we think is coming basically from leaky pipes to the beach, where does it jump up to roughly?
Well, at this time of year, it's like 3.3.
It jumps up that high?
I've seen it even up to 6.5. Just
wow.
Yeah, the beginning of January when we had the astronomical high tides. And it was...
peak. Instantaneous flow is 6 MGD.
Wow.
But only for, let's say, an hour.
Yeah.
But then it drops down, so the whole day ends up being
higher
than 3.3 or 3.5 or 3.6.
And so you think that roughly when will the Church Street pumping station actually start pumping right now?
End of this month.
Next month?
Just the end of this month.
Oh, end of this month. Okay. Thank you. That's all I have.
That's amazing.
Okay.
Pete, do you want to cover other things on the report?
Yeah, just one other. Mike, just Mike. And then we'll be done.
Okay.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I want to talk about where we've gone in the maintenance department.
Okay.
I'd like to start off with the vehicle maintenance division. Pleased to inform that we've implemented and the implementing process for all the vehicles into the new RTA system. So now our repair histories are in for all 110 units that we currently take care of within the town, which would be police, fire, buildings, recreation, ourselves. That once again will give us the capabilities for PMs, our parts, service and labor costs, and within doing this implementation we're able to put billing reports together, which I've sent to all the other following department heads through the RTA system. And it gives them their cost tracking, parts breakdown, labor costs. And the mechanic who did the work, so they're able to see that. And in regards to the building maintenance division, we've gone through and have been doing some aesthetic and weather-tight purposes for the water treatment plant and the press room with the painting, and gone through several pump stations and done some preventative and preserving and enhancing measurements to get them weather-tight through the winter and continue on through the spring. And for myself personally, for training, I started the management training that Chris has just completed in the first year. I just went through the first of 6 classes, so I'm pleased to say that, and that's no cost for our department as well. So everything seems to be going really well, and we're looking forward to spring and moving the department forward and continuing to do a good job.
Any questions or I've just got one. Sorry. Go ahead, Mike.
I was just wondering about pumping stations. I know. I think it's the first year I was a selectman. I noticed that the pumping station off of Lafayette Road, in behind the BP gas station, down in there, there's a pumping station right down that street, and I noticed that the fence was all tore up and all that sort of thing, and I had mentioned that to our current DPW director, and he supposedly took care of it. Now, do you go around and check all the pumping stations?
I believe it's Hackett Lane.
I think it's called Hackett Lane.
Yep.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, we went around, we repainted.
Those little streets get confusing to me. But anyway, Hackett Chevrolet used to be there, so it probably is Hackett Lane. So, but anyway, I was just wondering if we have like a routine where we check them all.
Absolutely.
Because I know there used to be one across the street from my house, and they used to check it all the time because there's a little alarm going off on the top practically every other day. So they were out frequently, and but that's long gone. Now, do you have little alarms where you can know at Public Works that pump station A has got some kind of a problem or wireless?
We more or less do the aesthetic work, where it'd be painting or, example of the fence, we fixed the fence, we painted it, and got it aesthetically pleasing for the residents around there. So,
well, how do you Mike's group does that.
There is alarms at all.
Okay, so that's a different group takes care of that side of it. Okay,
right.
Thank you. That's all I have. Thank you.
Just one question, Mike. Could you elaborate? One of the things in the report is computer problems with the scale house. Could you elaborate on that a little?
In regards to the scale house, my understanding is that there was previously before in the software, there was it wasn't actually purchased to do what it's actually trying to do now in all the seats that are with all the seats that are currently there for data entries. I guess there's a X amount of entries that can be kept in that system, and we're having so many people come to the transfer station that there's more entries than what that system can handle.
I think it's more than that. That's a piece of it, but I think the bigger piece is that it's old software, old technology, and with the new systems coming out, they're just not compatible. So we'll be looking at, you know, putting money into next year's budget to upgrade that system.
I may be confusing this with something else, but I remember not too long ago, I don't say maybe a couple of years, and I could be off a little bit, but I remember us purchasing a piece of software associated with that. I remember it had a very expensive software maintenance contract associated with it. I want to say it was with a firm out of Auburn, New Hampshire.
Could be. That would have been before my time. We haven't bought it since I've been here.
Okay.
The software.
But it wasn't. It's not like. I guess my point was is it wasn't. You know, I wouldn't dispute you when you say it was. You know, more than 2.5 years ago. But it wasn't a long, long time
right.
ago. So I'm kind of surprised to hear.
The card swiping system.
No, this was even after. This was even after after that. And it just stuck with me because it was one of those situations where the software maintenance of it was very expensive.
Yeah.
And the rationale for it being expensive is these are the people that market the program. They're the only ones you can get it from, and we have to have, you know, the support or whatever. But I'm just, anyway, I don't need to go any further. It's just surprising. It was not that, you know, and you say it was before your time. It's funny how 2 years often turns out to be 3 or 4 years, whatever. So.
I've got a little bit.
Okay, thanks very much. And
I have a couple of odds and ends. Are the two sludge trucks being rotated? I know the Fournier Press is beautiful. I mean, that is doing such a great job. No wonder Mike is smiling back there, because that is
no,
a beautiful piece.
Given its purpose to refer to it as beautiful.
It's a beautiful piece of equipment. So we're rotating
Beauty
the trucks like
the
Mike was discussing with you when we were over visiting.
Yes, the
excellent.
Plan. Yes, the plan is to get it up and running and put the work to it needs and to get it in a rotating shift.
Excellent. And hopefully fewer trips, because you're doing so well with the weight on the sludge. I still have pole barns on my radar. Are you gentlemen going to be giving a little consideration to those for the 2015 budget?
We're looking at a number of options that we would like
the town
to consider.
For housing the vehicles and getting them out.
Taking another, a fresh look at that whole issue.
Great. And my other thought is the, I'm still pursuing the possibility for roll-offs for furniture to have furniture tagged and charged for separately and disposed of separately so that we're not spending a fortune on the loads up at Turnkey. just dropping a little few thoughts. And I have a long memory.
Okay, Keith, do you want to move on then to the Church Street
thank you, Mike.
Pump station contract request?
I sent you all a memo requesting a time extension for the Church Street station. I did make an error with the time frame. I'd put down 56 days, and it's actually 35 days. Taking into consideration the weather as well as the dewatering issues, and the fact that I got to say that this project has just gone so well. Knock on wood, I'd say that. Still got 3 weeks to go. But to have a multi-million dollar project go forward like we have with only, I think, $6,000 in change orders is just unusual. And I really feel that that's the good work of Wright Pierce Engineers and the contractor as well as our own group overseeing it. So I think this is a very reasonable request. There's no extra cost for us. Even with the engineering work, because the contractor wasn't working, it wasn't like we were paying for the inspector to be out there. He's just sitting around. You know, the inspector only worked while they were working. So there's really no downside to this. It's still going to be operational within a reasonable amount of time. So I would just ask for the authority for Fred to sign the change order, giving them that 35-day extension.
I'll move, Mr. Chairman, that we authorize the manager to sign the time extension to the contract for the engineering.
No, to the contract.
Just the contract.
Construction.
Okay. I will second that, and just one question. If I understood it, that extension would still have substantial completion done by February 28th. So it's kind of a moot point anyway. So. Okay, all in favor?
Well, I have a question for you before we move on to the vote. So what does this extension do exactly?
It's given the contractor some extra time to do the full completion of the project, which is the, you know, the paving work, the whole project as a whole.
Yeah.
So that's what it's for.
Okay. Now, so if we're substantially going to be finished on February 28th, so when will we be really finished then?
Early May?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so within a few days of May 1st, something like that.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I don't have a problem with them having an extension with the weather being the way it's been this winter, and I wouldn't want to be out there working when it's cold, and I know you have to get the water out, and if the water's coming up, and if it freezes, well, you got another problem. I don't have any problem accepting all that. I was just curious now what our actual potential total finish date is. So when do you think you're going to switch the pumps? Is that 28th day?
Yeah.
So we should all come down and have popcorn, right, when we do that?
Okay. Well, it probably won't be as exciting as the fire station, but we'll try to have some good goodies down there.
Fireworks?
So we have a substantial completion, and then we have the final completion,
right,
and we have the two designated. So substantial completion, you need to have the project up and running.
Yep.
Recognizing there's going to be a punch list and a lot of, hopefully not a lot, but a number of outstanding items that need to be checked off and fixed, you know.
Oh, I don't have a problem with that. I was just curious what the final date is. Roughly the 1st of May, then.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
The weather to some extent.
Oh, sure.
To your comment, Keith, with only $6,000 in change orders, then ultimately that will come in, the whole project, including engineering and construction management, whatever, at $3.8 million then, which is $1 million less than the original. So ultimately, that $1 million is going to end up in the undesignated fund balance because it was part of the tax calculation in 2012. So that's great. All in favor? Unanimous. Keith, one question, as long as you're here. We had a couple of memos which you had sent to condominium associations, one being Rubens Driftwood and the other being Ice House Lane.
Yep.
And I think we discussed that issue before, so we're all familiar with what's going on. My only comment is I really wonder, and it's directed towards the snow as opposed to the trash, if we really need to say we're not going to do the snow plowing, you know, beginning March 1st. I wonder if we should just finish this season rather than sending them out looking for a snow plowing contractor for what might be a couple of storms in March and April.
Whatever the board wishes.
I would make a motion that we defer the date where we will cease snow plowing at these two associations until the end of this season.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
What is
the end of the season?
What is the season?
Yeah.
I would say that if you had to pick a worst case date, I'd say probably April 15th. Although the probability is.
And the only reason I'm asking is so it doesn't get too long in the tent so people can bid out those services to replace what they currently have.
Right. No, what I'm saying is this snow removal season and pick April 15th if you need to put a date on it. Okay, we had a vote. I didn't catch. All in favor?
I'm opposed.
Okay. Motion passes 4-1 with Woolsey opposed. All set, Keith?
All right. Thank you.
Approval of minutes of January 27th. Okay. Page 1. Page 2. Page 3. Page 4. And page 4. The 6 paragraph down, third line, I would just qualify that the purchase order in question that was listed at $54,000 and was really $1,000 was for cold patch. Just if there's any question on what that was. Page 5. No change to the minutes, but just for your information. There's some information here that where I had asked Mike a bunch of questions where I was headed as I wanted to make sure that the rec fund, assuming the $90,000 warrant article got approved, still would have money in it without factoring in 2014 income or whatever. And I did some quick calculations in my head. I looked at them the next day on a piece of paper, and I was wrong. It was actually, the minutes can stay the same because that's what I said. But I double counted the $90,000, so in reality, instead of $30,000 in the fund will have $120,000. So it's a lot better, a lot better situation than even we had thought at the time. So. Page 6, page 7, page 8, page 9, the third paragraph down, last sentence. There was a discussion on having a public hearing in the future. I would rephrase that there was an agreement on having a public hearing in the future. And I think, Fred, you've actually picked a date for
too.
Do you recall what that date
is? It's the last Monday of the month. It's the
24th. Okay, great. Okay, I'll make a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
Second.
Seconded by Selectman Pierce. All in favor? Unanimous. Okay. Town manager's report, Fred.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I like this good news. January recycling figures indicate that we've achieved a 35% recycling rate. The intake of regular non-recycled materials decreased by 7% overall across the town, while the amount of recycling increased by 5%. We could do that every month. We could save a small fortune for the taxpayers. The fire department recently requested the board to declare as surplus the old fire chief's car, a 2004 Taurus. The vehicle has extensive rot under the vehicle and has failed state inspections.
we'd like the board's permission to just sell it to a junkie as opposed to trying to get $25. $25 for it at an auction, we can probably get $300 or $400.
They've got the money, Phil.
I thought we already voted to declare it a surplus.
You did. We didn't allow us to do anything with it. It's just sitting there.
I'll so move.
Why would we do that?
I have no idea.
I will so move and get rid of it.
I'll second to getting rid of it.
Good idea.
All in favor?
And I think the last thing, Mr. Chairman, this late last week we had the finance director submit his resignation effective the 16th of May.
Yeah.
We have already advertised out. It hit the Municipal Association in Maine and New Hampshire today, Massachusetts tomorrow, and I believe the newspapers will be picking it up either tomorrow or Friday.
Did you need anything else on getting rid of that old police fire chief's car?
What? No, I think that we have voluntary authority to sell it to a junk dealer for whatever
scrap.
We get it for, a scrap.
Yeah.
That will take
That's
care of it.
2004 Ford? Wow.
It's a 2000 Taurus.
Yeah.
Year 2000?
Yes.
The vehicle chief.
A Ford like Taurus?
Yeah.
Remember the
fix and repair daily. I'm surprised that lasted more than 3 or 4 years.
Remember the vehicle chief life?
Was
drive
the chief's
around?
Car.
Yeah.
He didn't drive SUV or
right.
whatever.
Right.
He had the Taurus.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had never seen it move since he left.
They bought that. So
actually,
they
I have a couple of times. We're just concerned that if we didn't do something with it and
yes,
end up
yeah.
in an auction,
right.
somebody would buy it, try to drive it,
yeah.
Or try to fix it, and it would be a real lemon because it's completely gone.
Right.
And I don't want to see it rotting like some of those vehicles at Public Works. Yeah. Are we
okay,
meeting
questions?
Next Monday?
Already did.
Are we meeting
no,
next?
No, ma'am. Next Monday is a holiday.
That's okay. That's what I thought.
What is the holiday?
President's Day.
President's Day.
Oh.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Good.
Well, that's why I wanted
glad
to
you
first.
It's new this year. It's new this year, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions for Fred?
No. Thank you, Fred.
I have one issue I want to bring up. And
sure.
Just for the benefit of the board and whatever, and I had sent an email to Mark and Fred today. Mark, if you want to come up, you're up anyway, next with the SleepNet thing. But the
can I just get into some of the comments before we get into Fred's comments?
Okay.
How long has Mike Smoltz been with the team?
Ten years, I think.
August
said
of 2006.
A lot longer than you think, because when he... in his many younger days, he was a volunteer firefighter.
Yeah.
He was also the assistant building inspector for the town.
Mm-hmm.
So he's had a number of jobs for the town.
Right.
I'd have to go back and do some research, but he's got a lot more than 10 years.
He started his current position in August 2006,
right.
And it was a very tough start because he started in the position of finance director or whatever, and then a very short period of time later, like several days or a week or maybe two, the town manager at the time informed Mike that he was leaving. So here he is in a brand new job as a finance director with no town manager,
right.
which ultimately became Mark as the acting town
right.
manager.
Yep.
Well, I would just like to comment on what we all know, what an outstanding job that finance has done in service to the town.
Amen.
And when the auditors come in and they speak about... The, exactly. And I've spoken to the last couple of weeks and again today, and their comments about how well the numbers are run in this town, how well this town is run, and through my 2 years of tenure on this board, Mike is snap on with responses. His accuracy and his professionalism have been extraordinary. I trust, Mr. Chairman, that you already have a plan to recognize his departure. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't want to let that announcement go without us a comment. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. the issue that I wanted to bring up is the situation with the seawalls and our procedures and the leases and whatever. And quite frankly, I'm just getting a little concerned at the time that has elapsed. I think it was back around the middle of November that the individual that was in that had to do with 16 to 32 Nor'east Lane. And I recall at the time the contractor was looking to get started by March 1st.
Yep.
We're only a few weeks away from March 1st. We don't have the administrative stuff done. I think Fred had told him at that time that he had to be done by April 15th.
Yeah.
So I'd hate to see a situation where because of administrative stuff we're delaying him from starting, although we may not be, because he also made a comment during that meeting about doing some work in Rye.
Mm-hmm.
So he had some limitations on his own end
right.
as to when he was going to be able to start. But I just kind of wanted to get an update. I just get a sense with deliberative session and warrant articles or whatever that that may have, you know, been on the shelf for a while. I just want to make sure that we're pulling it off the shelf and when we might anticipate seeing something like that so that we can move forward. I did notice that there's another couple of, just from planning board stuff, there's another couple of other properties right down in that same section of town, one of which is, I think actually had a DES emergency repair already approved.
I have about 12 pending.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
And weather, Richard, is going to be a factor in some of this, too. If they think they're going to get this done by April 15th, that may be...
Right, but what I just want to make sure is to the extent that we have the ability that we're not slowing up. So, Mark, what's your take on that from a time frame situation or whatever?
I understand that there's going to be some that are coming in front of the board, not obviously next Monday, but the Monday thereafter.
It's a combination effort of Fred, myself, and Ed Tinker. I produced a draft of a lease, and Fred and Ed and I have met on that, and a number of suggestions. Obviously, we're dealing with a hybrid situation. It's not your typical lease of leased land down at of lots. It's a variable of that, and so it involves taxability. It involves especially insurability and indemnification of the town, which is a very big issue. And not just that, but making sure that people confine their activities to the area where you've given them permission, and the design that you've permitted. We've had situations where people have gone way beyond what they've said they were going to do. And of course, the lease is the tail end of a process that actually begins with other boards where a special permit is needed. So we're trying to coordinate all of those and also plan administratively for a rollout of this, which is going to involve all of those who occupy town land, not just those who are coming in front of you for a permit.
Good.
Okay, so when would you, for example, we've got the 16-32 Northeast Lane, which I think was the one that was first into the queue, if you will, or whatever. What is the process that you would anticipate coming to us with a draft of a lease for our approval prior to approaching the property owners?
I don't know what Fred's indicated that they would next be there, but we have 2 weeks until the next meeting.
We actually haven't indicated anything to the property owners. But I would certainly expect that I would send a copy when it's finished to the board.
I'd like to see a draft before we actually approach.
There's also a whole series of, like in the planning board, when you're authorizing something to be built in your property, of point items that you need to vote on a sheet. And we'll have one for every piece of property so that there's no misunderstanding about what you're approving or what you're doing.
So you would anticipate then that we would have that for our approval for the meeting on the 24th then?
Correct.
And
has anybody been in touch with the contractor or the engineer or whatever since November?
Christina's been in touch with several of them.
I think it kind of would be meaningful to understand where he is at. For example, one of the things that the comments that he made, I think it's Bauer, is that right?
Yeah, I think it's Bauer.
And I think he was looking more at it from the standpoint of him finishing up what he was doing in Rye and getting on site, is that if he didn't feel like he could start and finish it by the time frame, he was, I think, going to defer it to September.
Right.
Or whatever. So I think somebody should let him know.
We'll give him a call, see what he's up to, and see where he is.
Okay, thanks. Old business, Mark, close out of the CDBG SleepNet.
Oh, yes, the project that never ends.
Is this the closeout of the closeout of the...
The closeout. Yeah. We haven't been sleeping on this. I want you to know that.
Well, we thought that agreement that it took a while to get into shape back in November was it, but no, it is not. There are a couple of other documents. These are actually entitled closeout, so maybe there's some comfort in that. Closeout certification and documentation, which is one of them, and that is the more extensive of the two documents, and that is one that I made some modifications to to be sure that the it drew in the agreement that was signed, so that in the course of releasing the state from liabilities, we were also acknowledging that they agreed that we had done what we could do. And also, this was an agreement that wasn't initially going to be signed by the Coastal Economic Development Commission, but now is.
Good.
And then there's the closeout agreement document, which is much simpler, which is simply signed by this Community Development Finance Authority, and as well as Fred, if you authorize him to. And I think if you have two documents that say close out, maybe it means that.
It does. Should be.
So at the end of the day, you think we're covered as far as being off the hook for any liability?
Now,
that's the question.
A lot of that depends.
Depends. Here we go.
That's a bad question.
All the payments being made that are set forth in that agreement that we signed back in November, the agreement stream.
I'm not going to add any of my usual comments. Thank you.
That's all right.
I move to authorize Town Manager Welsh to sign on the town's behalf the closeout certification and documentation and the closeout agreement as reviewed and revised by Town Council.
I
have a second? Seconded by Woolsey. Further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Abstained. Motion passes 4-0-1 with Bean abstaining. Through it. Any other old business?
Actually, if you wanted a legal opinion about what the end of the season is, I looked in the RSAs and it's July 1.
Really?
July 1.
Wow. End of what season?
I picked April 15th because
I used to
ski 50 or 60 times a year at Loon Mountain, and the latest I remember a snowstorm that was skiable was April 13th, and that's in Lincoln, New Hampshire. So I thought I was safe, but maybe not.
Is it fair to ask Council about the meeting with NextEra, that face-to-face thing?
I think that should be left.
That's
to
Ed Tinker's been in correspondence with them.
Okay.
Whatever.
We're still corresponding.
Yes.
Any other old business? I have one. Mary Louise, we have talked about you talked with the town clerk about the non-emergency notification system and if there was something that
I
they could do to help out.
I talked to Jane and she said basically forget it. People will just throw the pieces of paper all around the place and it will create a dreadful mess. And so we were talking about the possibility. Basically, if you're giving people pieces of paper that they don't want, they're going to just throw them all over the place. So that may be a cynical approach. I don't know, but so we were thinking in terms maybe of putting the papers or the sign up on the console or that little table thing, and maybe put a sign on it. You know,
there they are now. We're gonna have a sign made up to sit behind it so people can see.
Sign up here for because we really do want people signing up for notifications.
Oh yeah,
town clerk would prefer not
a
to
ton of hurt.
Okay,
be involved. I did speak with her at the deliberative session.
That's too bad, but maybe a sign will help or whatever. But I mean, I just feel, aside from the town clerk, that getting to the point where we've got 3,000 or 4,000 or 5,000 people signed up for that versus not having those systems when DPW has to decide at the last minute they're not picking up trash or whatever is just huge.
She said it could conceivably tie up the flow of the lines going
through. What if she put some kind of a little thing directing the people over to that bench right in front of one of her windows? No?
Maybe she could put a little sign.
Okay.
She said it would interrupt the flow of business, basically, and
she gets
to scoop people through fast.
No problem with all that.
Well, they could always register their car online and then come in and do the paperwork.
Okay, new business. I put an item on here, IT policy, related to monitoring and intercepting of information. And I sent both an email, and Christina put a copy in your box, and there's really only two sentences that I have a concern with, and I just wanted to see what I talked with the town attorney, I talked to Fred, talked to Paul, and I'll just give you kind of the background on this.
Mr. Chairman, can I just briefly interrupt? And we didn't get this until Friday.
this request, and we kind of have a procedure, if I may humbly just
bring
it. Let me just bring this up before we get into it. And this is about an IT policy, but at any rate, Friday is when we received it. And I know that it hasn't been chopped by the IT. There's no. Let me just finish.
Go ahead.
Are you okay?
I'm not asking to approve anything tonight.
I just wanted to bring this up and say that when we bring this up on a Friday for the agenda, we do have a procedure that roll call is on Wednesday. This is a significant policy. It's about tech. I'm sure it's about our cell phones. It's about privacy. Well, I'm reading that. I've been educated in Hampton schools. At any rate, I don't have a chop from the attorney. I don't have a chop from the town manager. I don't have a chop from Paul. I don't see Paul here. It's his department. You can tell me what he said, but I'm not hearing Paul say that. And I would respectfully defer this to next week.
Okay.
Thank you.
I do not wish to defer it. I also do
like to make a motion that we defer this to next week.
Can I continue before?
I'd like to make a motion that we defer this to next week, please.
Two weeks.
Can I speak before? Okay.
There's a motion on the floor.
First of all. Okay, discussion.
You're going to call for a second?
Mary Louise seconded, okay.
Thank you.
First of all, the information was available on Friday. It was on Friday's agenda. That's number one. Number two, okay, I have no need for us to make a decision on this tonight. Mm. I simply want to start the discussion, okay? So in terms of deferring any decision, I have absolutely no problem with that, okay? My point is we need to start the discussion, and I would like to do that tonight, okay? So if I can continue. I only have a concern with a couple of sentences which I highlighted. I sent it out by email Thursday mm-hmm. or Friday, and then Christina put it in the box on Friday. And let me read those sentences. Which the town may examine at any time. The town manager or his designee reserves the right to monitor, review, audit, intercept, access, and disclose all messages sent and received, except for confidential information. My concern is that this policy is too open-ended. It's almost like NSA-like of Big Brother being able to just snoop an employee's emails. If we wouldn't listen to their phone conversations, I don't think we should be just open-ended snooping on their emails. Let me qualify that. Number one, this policy, if you look in the bottom in a very small font, goes back to July of 2000. I'm not sure anybody was even aware of this. Until I read it. I've talked to Fred, I've talked to Paul. This is not something that we're doing, okay? It is simply something that is in the policy. I would advocate in the area just of these two or three sentences that we simply add some language that simply says for cause. In other words, we just don't do it for the heck of it. There's got to be some cause, and I would add to that as determined probably by the town manager and the town attorney, as opposed to just open-ended, where we have the right to monitor, review, audit, intercept, access, and disclose all messages sent and received. I don't think we should be just doing that without cause to employees either.
Well, I would propose that, like any private business, the computer system is owned, in this case, by the public, by the taxpayers, and you should be restricted to the professional use required in the conduct of people's employment. And I think that, and I noticed particularly in here, too, with the passwords that it be kept confidential, which, of course, was a big problem with that NSA breakout. I don't have a problem. I can't imagine the town manager wanting to take time running through everybody's email. Right? He's got enough to do. But if circumstances arise, I really don't have any problem with that language. And this is town-owned property, public property, that is intended for the use of the workforce. I wouldn't think of going on my computer at work and doing other stuff. I mean, it's not appropriate. And I think what's appropriate in the private sector is equally appropriate in the public sector for anyone in the employ of the people who are running the business. And we're running a business, and it's called a town.
Well, you know what my view, I don't feel it's appropriate for us to be, have a policy, not to be, okay? I don't believe we're doing that. Fred has told me we're not doing it. Paul has told me we're not doing it, okay? But I don't believe a policy which enables us to do that without cause, okay, is appropriate. Like I said, we wouldn't listen in on employees' phone calls. I don't see why we should be have a policy that allows us without cause to search through employees' emails.
Well, what do you infer there that means without cause?
As what I believe is that that action, okay, of monitoring, reviewing, auditing, intercepting, mm-hmm. accessing, and disclosing all messages
yeah.
should only be done when some combination, and I'm going to pick two people, the town manager and the town attorney, mm-hmm. feel that there is cause for doing so.
Well, if they didn't feel there was cause, they wouldn't do it. God knows they've got enough to do.
No, that's not what this says, though. I mean, this basically says they can appoint somebody to do that mm-hmm. in that role, literally.
Mm-hmm. The town manager can appoint Joe off the street to do it for him, and I don't know if I want Joe off the street looking at my private emails as a selectman to you.
It's not your private emails.
Mr. Chairman, I do have a motion on the floor, and I just would offer this, that I have worked on taxpayer computers throughout my life. I never thought they were mine. I never thought that the words that I put on
Correct.
Those computers were my sole province. Mm-hmm. They were regularly monitored. My workstation was shared.
Mm-hmm.
Some of it was top secret, compartmentalized, and I never felt that it was mine. I worked for the government. And I agree with Mary Louise Woolsey, and I do see that they have some strong opinions here. I would like to hear from the town manager. I would like to hear from the town attorney. I would like to hear from IT. And having said that, I have the utmost confidence in the integrity and professionalism of all of our employees here. And again, there's a motion on the floor to push this
so
back a couple of weeks.
So your motion is essentially to defer and resume the discussion on February 24th?
Yes. With appropriate town manager, legal, and IT input.
So to the February 24th meeting?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All in favor? I'm fine with that. Okay.
Also move the consent agenda, Mr. Chairman.
Other new business?
Wait a minute. We have a couple of items outstanding, Mr. Chairman. I don't know if it's under new business or old business, but did we vote on the investment policy?
That's on the consent agenda.
Do we need to discuss that?
Let's address that when we get to the consent agenda, and if you'd like to remove that off the consent agenda for discussion, that's fine. I have one other item under new business. Rennie Cushing has requested that I testify on a couple of bills this Thursday related to the pollution control exemption mitigation. There are two bills, one of which involves language that seeks to give the municipalities control over whether or not those exemptions exist. The second of which essentially sunsets the exemption after 25 years or whatever. So with the board's consent, Ed Tinker and I will plan on heading up Thursday and testifying in favor of those bills.
25 years from the inception of the actual type business?
The language, that's a good question. I had the same question. The language of that second bill, HB 1311, basically just said after 25 years or whatever. One thing I did ask Ed Tinker to research, and he did today, and he can actually find going back to 1985. He hasn't gone further back. I'm not
mm-hmm.
sure there's a need to.
Yeah.
Actual tax bills to the Seabrook station,
right.
as well as the fact that the pollution control exemption
mm-hmm.
was factored
yeah.
into those tax bills. So we're already at 29 years
right.
and maybe longer. So
right.
But that needs to be specified, whatever language they're
right.
putting
sure.
in.
No, I'm
just leaving it at 25
you
years.
You just want a consensus on your going?
My feeling is when somebody testifies, whether it's a selectman,
yep.
a town manager, whatever, on behalf of the town of Hampton
mm-hmm.
up in Concord,
right.
then that should be
absolutely
with the approval of the
yeah.
selectman. We
right.
had a couple of situations where that wasn't the case, and I didn't think that was right. So
that's good.
I've always brought it up before I've
yeah.
Thank you.
Done it.
Good.
The other comment
the
I'd like to make,
yeah.
and I'm going to go to one of Dave Lang's points in public comment tonight and just get something out there, and it has to do with the action of the deliberative session. Dave has indicated, and he was quoted in the paper, saying he believes the voters' action at the deliberative session nullifies the town of Hampton's ability to pay its dues to the NHMA. I don't agree with that. It's my understanding that the intent and the authority of the deliberative session is for explanation, discussion, and debate of each warrant article. The deliberative session can amend the wording and dollar amounts of proposed ballot measures, but no actual voting on the merits of the proposals takes place. The March session is when issues such as the town budget and other warrant articles are voted on. Mm-hmm. As you know, the NHMA dues are in the default budget. Mm-hmm. I think Dave's position is worthy of discussion. However, I think the time to address that issue is following the mm-hmm. vote on March 11th. Yeah. So, at any rate.
Can I add something to that? I was just curious what he meant by some select and almost threatening with bodily harm to come in here and testify. What was that all about?
I don't know.
I didn't follow that. Did you follow what he said about that coming into the selectman's room? And he said something and didn't click at all with me. Did I miss something there? I had to go back and watch the tape, I guess.
Yep. Yes. Okay.
I move the consent agenda.
Mike, would you like to remove the investment policy?
Well,
for
I just
discussion?
Had some questions about it, yes.
Okay.
Please.
Mary Louise, would you like to amend that to move item 2 on the consent
agenda? Yes, why don't we just move item 2 for now?
And those are a number of veterans credits. I will second that. All in favor? Unanimous.
Excellent.
Okay. Discussion of the investment policy fiscal year 2014.
Mike? Question. It looks like this is investment policy is fiscal year 2014 when I was perusing through it. Is this a carbon copy of what it was last year, Fred?
I can respond to that.
Okay.
One of the observations I made when I looked at this and I looked at the financial report is that it did not address service charges. And what's happened over the last 6 or 7 years, for example, if you go back to 2007, we actually had a plus $133,000. That was back in the good old days where you got 2%, 3%, 4% interest. You back the service charges out and you still had $133,000 or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That number is gradually degraded. 2008, it dropped to $38,000. I think we all remember what happened in 2008. 2009, it started getting into negative numbers, negative $4,000. It was negative $18,000 by 2011, negative $30,000 by 2012, and we're probably looking at something in the range of negative $40,000 or $45,000 after we close the books on 2013. So my only point was very simple, is that the investment policy should somehow recognize the fact that minimizing service charges is part of that investment policy. So there are three words which Mike Schwarzer added to that after our discussion, and I'll read the whole sentence and point out the difference.
Which page?
If you look at page 1, Roman numeral 3, general objectives.
Okay.
The primary objectives of investment activities in order of priority shall be safety, liquidity, yield, and then what was added, and minimizing service
Good.
Charges. So
Good.
That's it's simply that simple, and what it basically does is it gives direction centrally that you're looking at the net of the yield on the investments and the service charges and what the result is.
Right.
It still falls behind safety and liquidity in the prioritization scheme.
So this one is dated February 3, 2014, does not include that, so that's the old one.
February 10th.
And the one that is dated February 10th
right.
has the addition.
Yep, that's correct.
So all we're doing is changing, adding those three words?
Correct.
Actually, the one to be signed is February 3rd, but those three words are in it.
Right. So this one here is just definitely erroneous.
I don't know. I'm holding the one that's supposed to be signed. It says February 3rd, so.
But it has that language.
It has that language in it, yes.
Yeah, I'm looking at the copy that showed up.
And I was comparing the two. I didn't catch that, so I'm just
I think they probably just didn't change the.
Yep.
That's all I had. I was just curious why we were going through this
Well, if you recall, it was also deferred last week because we were not provided that
yes.
in the packet
right.
on Friday.
And I thought we'd have some discussion on it, that's what I was wondering about. I'm
okay.
all set. Thank you, Mr.
I will make a motion to approve the investment policy for fiscal year 2014.
I'll second that.
All in favor? Unanimous. Any closing comments?
Just remind the public that we will not be meeting next Monday night in case they're afraid to miss their favorite show.
Reality TV.
I do have a couple
questions.
Who's
reality?
When you've already sent out notices and so forth for the new to replace Mike, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, we have sent the ads out. Yeah.
So what's your, from your experience, when would we start getting people back to look at the?
We should start seeing information coming in with about within about a week.
Week or two.
We'll start receiving information coming through.
Because the way it looks to me, he's going to leave in May.
May 16th. He officially retires the last day of May.
And how much money do we allow in the budget for?
1 month.
1 month.
1 month. If the regular budget passes, if it does not, there's zero.
That means we have to take out your paycheck, Fred.
Uncle Sam does every day.
I'm all set.
Motion to adjourn. I'll make a motion to adjourn.
At 8:32 p.m.
Seconded by Selectman Plouffe. All in favor? Unanimous. We're adjourned.